I'll tell you the result. The result was 3,000 to 4,000 young people saved every night in Australia. And then church by television, this is for you. You pastors that are coming down on your young people because they want to play rock. Let me tell you something. You need to disciple your young people instead of just cutting them loose and saying no. You young people, before you go out and rock anybody, you need to get on the rock that doesn't roll. Let the rock that doesn't roll rock you, and then you might be ready to rock somebody else. The reason I'm not doing this in the United States of America is I have not found a church or a body throughout the United States that will plug into this. I'm not a salmon. I don't like to swim upstream. If I want exercise, I'll play racquetball. And I'm not going to see young people come by the thousands to Jesus Christ and then watch the church drop the ball and not disciple them or bring them in. In Australia, and Andrew Evans will back this up, the Assemblies of God, they called me and they said 70% of every person that received Jesus Christ at the outreaches in Australia is now serving God in the churches throughout Australia. Church, you need to wake up. You need to remember the scripture that says in Isaiah, I will bring you treasures. Out of where? Out of darkness. So that you will know that I am the Lord your God. People, I did not mean to get going, but I'll tell you, I could go all night, but I gotta pull my plug here. I apologize if I'm running amok here, brother. Praise God. I want to sing praises to the Lord Jesus Christ, and I want you people to start praying, not necessarily just for me, but for the people that God's bringing in. See, one thing that bothers me, I got a very big mouth. That doesn't bother me. But what does bother me is I have a big mouth, and if I'm catching the grief that I'm catching, I hate to think what these baby Christians are getting when they're walking in, coming out of their death clothes. Took me 5 years to get perfect. I want to sing Hosanna, brother. I love you. I praise God for your tenacity, your perseverance, and your strength. Praise the Lord. I wouldn't want to get involved in an endurance test with you. Praise the Lord. That's why we're here.
Hosanna! holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of heaven and earth, filled with your glory. Great Jesus, Hosanna, Hosanna,
let's hear for Jesus.
Thank you, Jeff. What a precious brother. Give him a big hand. I'm glad he took the time to speak to you. Praise God. What a pleasure for me to introduce you next, our brother Murillo, I can't say it. You know, I was just sitting there thinking, what a team. Jeff and Mario. Let me tell you, wait a minute. I've been all around the world, but I have never met a man so deep, so young, so articulate as Mario. I love him. God, I send it for the youth of America. We should send this team around the world and bring in harvest of young people, right? Let's welcome our speaker, Mario. Give him welcome.
I need to ask you to stand. Somebody said something there. Amen. I want you to stand with me, if you will. How many of you hate the devil in this room right now? You know, I think that there is a desire on the heart of people to shout unto the Lord and praise him out loud. So let's not let one or two carry the weight. Let's all praise the Lord right now. Let's all praise the Lord. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's something in your heart that wants to come out. Now let Jesus take control of you now and praise the name of the Lord with all of your heart right now. Everyone, raise your hands to heaven and pray in that language that God has given you. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Hallelujah, Jesus. The whole nation is watching now, my friends. And I want you to divert your prayer now to binding the devil in North America in the name of Jesus. Wherever you are, just take on that battle and say, in the name of Jesus, we bind the devil in the United States of America. If you're a missionary or an apostle from another nation visiting us, you could feel when you arrive the need of America. We're a backslidden country and we need the power of God. And Father, give us fire in our bones right now. Tell the devil you're not afraid of him. Tell the world you are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We glorify you. Jesus. Amen. Now before you're seated, hallelujah. Before you're seated, I want all of you to listen carefully. I had two sermons tonight, and I was in a strait between which one I was supposed to preach. And a very kind brother, a priest, walked up to me, and he looked at me rather sternly, and he said, "The Lord has given you a specific word, and you're to share it." I want to tell you that that was not really what I was hoping to hear. I was hoping somebody would say, "Now, be nice." And I'm going to attack the devil, nobody else. I'm going to attack the devil. And I want you to understand before I open my mouth what my hesitancy to share what the Lord gave me was brought on by. There are few men in my age group that fully understand the power, the calling, and the history of the full gospel businessman the way I do. I know what God has done and is doing with this fellowship. I know that there are ministries that have spoken at conventions like this that were unknown to the world until they spoke in this convention. And then the Lord used this organization to promote them to a level of power they never ever understood before. So I had severe reverence for this speaking engagement, and I do. I personally believe that there are men of God that could not have ever done what they were called to do if it were not for their opportunity to speak in a world convention like this. So when I came, I said, "Father, I thank you for the blessing and the honor and the privilege of speaking tonight. And I can't tell you how much I want to tell you the truth right now. I believe that tonight you are to get rid of your normal convention spirit, and this is to be turned into an upper room, and we need a new baptism of power from the Holy Ghost on all of us." Come on, somebody, on all of us. I do not dare use your time with story after story of what God has done for me. There is something about tonight that speaks of destiny, of history, of a new page in the book of Acts. And for me to preach the word that I have for you means this. I want you to know that though my last name is not Roberts or Kuhlman, that tonight in this building, quite distinct from me, the Lord wants to move in such awesome signs and wonders that people with lifetime diseases, paralysis, and even death is supposed to be bound and set free. People are supposed to, in front of these cameras tonight, in front of the whole nation, God wants to bring Satan to total humiliation. Are you with me? Come on, somebody, get excited right now. Are you with me? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I do not care if our ministry expands one inch because of this opportunity tonight. I do not care if a single name is added to our mailing list or if anyone remembers how to pronounce my name or not. Because my concern, my heart, is to see the Lord's will for this convention done. I want to see what God wants said, said. What God wants done, done. You didn't come here by accident. You're not here for a light sunlight routine in July in Anaheim. There ain't gonna be no magic mountain here, or space mountain, or frontier land, or tomorrow land. This is Holy Ghost land that we're in tonight. Go ahead and shout, somebody. Give God the glory. Hallelujah. I want to thank you so much for bearing with me on that. Now tell somebody beside you, tell them, say, Jesus is going to bless your socks off. And then you may be seated. Wow, what a night. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to give us your heart on this word that has come forth. Speak it to us, Lord, because our ears are open and our hearts are willing. Spare us, have mercy on us, and speak by your Holy Spirit right now. Bless the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, I need everyone's help. Everyone, please look this way. I'm going to preach to you tonight from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 1. And I want all of you that have a Bible to open to it now. And I want my friends who are here tonight, who are very excited and boisterous and outgoing, I want you to know I'm glad you're here. You know, the devil is scared of these people. You believe that? Amen. And I want you to give me an opportunity to get what the Lord has given me out. And then all of us are going to give a shout unto God tonight that I think will break some of the lighting fixtures. Yes. I want you to let me, in the interim, preach this word and say this word. This is going out because of the generosity of Paul and Jan Crouch and the great ministry that they have, this is going out to many, many people, millions. And while I want you to feel a part of what we're doing, I want those of you in the audience to not feel like you are a television audience, but you are the people of God in a Holy Ghost upper room about to receive power from on high. Amen. I told you something at the beginning, that I am probably more sensitive and aware of the history of this movement than many preachers my age, because the roots of this movement and many others like it happened between the years of 1947 and 1952. And that five-year period was one of the earth's most significant expressions of power. Not only did Israel become a nation in that period, Billy Graham was raised up in that period, Oral Roberts was raised up in that same period, Catherine Kuhlman was raised up in that very same time, and the Full Gospel Businessmen. I believe that if the devil were to point to 5 years that he remembers with the greatest amount of consternation and dread, it would be the years 1947 to 1952. It was a cluster of power that was extraordinary. And tragically, there are a lot of young people in this room that don't even know what I've just said is true. They have no idea. I was influenced very, very strongly by two people. One of them is a name that unfortunately is not common enough in the memory of young preachers. And that is Dr. Charles Price, who was a man of God. You say, for those of you that are needing this kind of spiritual credential, to show you what kind of a man he was, he had a meeting in Seattle where he waved his hand, and in a matter of span of a few minutes, 50 people left wheelchairs and were healed instantly by the power of God. He was a gentle giant, a man who spoke very eloquently and gently, rarely raising his voice. But he would paralyze audiences for 2 and 3 hours at a time with his preaching. Well, here's a man that I never met who died the same year I was born and whose writings lived on and made me alive in Jesus Christ. And if you would forgive me for saying so, there are a lot of Christian bestsellers today that I esteem to be pulp compared to the writings of Dr. Charles Price. For the man walked with God in power and in might. Then there was a little lady that one day these ministers told me, don't go hear her preach because she's weird. How many of you are rebellious? Raise your hand. See, a lot of you didn't raise your hand. You're rebelling against me. Now try it again. How many of you tend a little bit to be rebellious? Raise your head. Yes. How many of you, if somebody told you not to go hear somebody preach, you might go just because they told you not to? Fortunately for me, I went to hear this woman 3 hours early. That's how I got in the building. And she was unusual. She had a fan on the stage. And she came out twirling and moving around. When she opened her mouth, she didn't talk like you and I would speak, but everything was exaggerated. And I had been waiting for her. But there was an undeniable residence of power on that woman that in our century we have ever seen. We've never seen anything like it on anyone else in this country. It was like there was Catherine Kuhlman over here and everyone else. And there were a lot of wannabes, and then there was her. And it was as though you could walk into one of her meetings and the most avowed skeptic, a person who didn't believe in the law of gravity, would watch little children with polio healed by the power of God. Tumors that were beyond number vanish. Might and glory that was undeniable. You see, what happened in 1948 to 1952 in that five-year period was the convulsive birthing of a generation of power. More souls were saved by the ministries raised up in that five-year period than in any five-year period of the entire church's history of the last 2,000 years. Hello, somebody say amen, please. And you need to appreciate what I'm telling you. If you don't know this, you need to know it. I was too young to remember it. But I have lived in it, and I've worshiped God in it. And I want you to know that now we live 40 years later. We are 40 years from that time, what the Bible calls a generation. And there is something that we've got to say, and we say it honestly. The roar of apostolic lions that change cities and abandon wheelchairs and deliver the lost. The roar of spiritual giants is not in the land tonight as it once was. And it is not an admission of failure. It is not an indictment of this generation. It is this. When you go down by the beach and the tide is out so far that you can walk hundreds of feet out into the ocean area you could never walk before, there's two things you can surmise. One, the tide is out. Two, the tide is going to come back in. And let me tell you something. A fool would go down to the very end of that sand and sit there arrogantly supposing that that real estate will always be available to him. How many of you know that Satan reclaims land whenever we let him? And when the tide of fervor goes out, real estate that was ours becomes his again. Look at the stupidity of our leaders in this country right now. We have a rap group that every other word is an obscenity. And they're allowed to say whatever they want. While at the same time, our Supreme Court bans manger scenes in any public building. How many of you know there is something being said right now by our government? We would rather hear cuss words than to see a manger scene. One little old lady that I was on the radio in Phoenix, she said this about our government. She said, our leaders are so open-minded, their brains have fallen out. Somebody say amen, please. Can you believe that? A Christian came up to me and he said, thank God that this bill before the Congress is having a tough time. The one where parents still have the right to know if their teenagers are having abortions. I looked at him and I thought, are we at the point now where we can feel a sense of achievement that the most inane and evil bill in the history of America, that someone would dignify the possibility that a parent should not be allowed to know when their children are killing the unborn? How many of you know it's insanity that we would even give that credence at all? How many of you know that's insane? I don't even want to dignify the question. I want to stand here and say, where in the world did you get off even thinking that that's a viable right? So here we are, 1990, one of the most important years in the history of the world. It's the last decade of the 20th century, the last 10 years, and if you want to know how far away the year 2000 is, just think back to 1980 And that's how far we are from the year 2000. It's around the corner. We're going to change decades, century, and millennium. And in this period of time, I want you to understand that it is starting to feel like Jesus told us that there was a way to read the signs of the times, to look at it and say, what are the signs of the time? When you know the sky is red, it is a weather warning. And I'm warning you that it, when there has not been an earthquake in a long, long time, expect the big one. When the tide is out, don't presume that it won't come back in. It is overdue. If I were to look at you and say, what is the one glaring spiritual void in America right now and in the world? It is the production of preachers, prophets, apostles, and pastors that know how to historically and courageously not be in it for the money, not be entertainers, not be spineless wimps that can be bought and bartered on the marketplace of preaching, but are men and women like were born in 1948 to 1952. Men who hear from God, women who hear from God, people who say, my anointing is not to pay the bills or survive, but to change the very course of the nation that I live in. And I'm going to do it for the glory of God. Somebody give God the glory right now. I am not going to sit here and condemn our Bible schools, although there are some of them that I now consider non-profit organizations. I told one such learning institution, this is by no means a blanket condemnation of them, but I told one of them, I said, y'all are graduating into being a pack of singing psychologists. You know how to counsel. You know how to play the piano. You know how to deal with depression. You know how to deal with singing. But you have not a clue to pulling the trigger of God's power on this generation. And you don't understand sacrifice. Sacrifice is dropped out of the terminology of preachers and Christians today. And when Miss Kuhlman would repeatedly say that all of the power of her ministry was the result of dying to self, that in many charismatic quarters, the phrase dying to self has been banned or obliterated or banished. For now it has been replaced by the idea that because I am merely a king's kid, I have a right to power. And the idea of self-sacrifice is not there. And I'm going to tell you something. We may have been convinced, my friend, that we are king's kids. We may have been convinced that we have inherent rights and privileges. But we ain't scaring the devil. And we are not changing America. And I believe that we've got to wake up and see, number one, that the reason we aren't is that we protect our young people from being committed to Christ the way they should be. We think that we had it rough, they ought to have it easy. And if you do that, you're going to give them a life where they have not the power. You see, what the devil regards is not my ability to speak, your ability to speak, your ability to believe, my ability to believe. But when the work of the cross of Christ is done in a man's life and in a woman's life, where the Lord says, you, my servant, have paid the price. You are not in this for fame or glory or self-enrichment. You're in this to be used of God and the anointing. How many of you know it's the anointing that we need? It's the anointing. Somebody help the priest. It's the anointing that we need. And it is an anointing to change a nation. Now that I've said that, I'm going to warn you that I am persuaded that we are now at a point that it resembles in every detail 1948 to 1952. That it has come. There's some names you don't know and I don't know. People you're not used to and I'm not used to. We're going to have some weird women preaching again. We're going to have some nation-shaking men and women of God raised up. How many of you still love me even though I've said this? Do you? I truly believe that if there is one thing about Satan that is almost inalienably true, is that he has serious mental retardation. And the product of that retardation is that he always forgets God's capacity to produce a secret weapon. If you were to have met Goliath and he was in some bar drinking a light beer from Miller, here's a 9.5-foot man, and some guy walks up to him and says, "How do you think you'll die?" He said, "I'll probably be killed by 25 men with spears, because that's what it'll take." And have a prophet look at him and say, "Would you believe a 12-year-old boy with a little rock?" Or then presume to meet in the barracks 1,000 Philistines. Ask them how they're going to die. All of you, 1,000 men, will die at the hand of one man who will have in his hand an archaeological exhibit. And here we are in 1990, and America is in the hands of evil, homosexuality, AIDS, pornography, child abuse that's pandemic, television violence that is beyond absurdity. It has never been worse, and yet I look at it, and I'm going to tell you that God has got a shock for Satan that is unlike anything he has ever seen before. And it will come in a form that will astound the world, and it will astound the news media, and it will catch them completely off guard. How many of you are ready for that? Raise your hand right now. How many of you want to predict it right now? How many of you want to agree with me in prayer that it will happen? 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 1. This is not an auspicious way to begin a book of the Bible, but the Bible doesn't deal in catering to our needs or our life, but in telling the truth. And it says, "Now King David was old, advanced in years, and they put covers on him, but he could not get warm." Now I'm going to move down a few verses, if you will. Verse 5, "Then Adonijah, the son of Haggith, exalted himself, saying, 'I will be king.'" That is the era from 1985 till today that I believe that we have lived in. Self-proclaimed apostles and leaders of the church. Not raised up by God, not ordained of God, but taking advantage of the age and the absolute 40-year period that we've had giants in the land, and that era has come. David is old, and Adonijah starts shooting his mouth off. Now let me tell you quickly that Adonijah proclaimed himself king, and I have been disillusioned. You see, I'm not talking to you tonight like an evangelist. And in fact, I usually love a room full of sinners. And I love to preach to the church when God makes me. But by and large, I'm out there with the lost, leading them to the Lord. And I am going to tell you from my heart that Adonijahs are pandemic in the church right now. They're selling their books, their tapes. They're standing up saying they're lying, saying they've had visions. They are proclaiming themselves as having been called of God when they're not. And there are many, many running around teaching and training the church on the disease that I call spiritual instantism. The overnight quick fix, mature, microwave Christian of the cosmetic renewal. And they'll rent without a pastor or an organization that's legitimate like this backing them. They'll rent some hall and sell some tape to you about how to be an overnight spiritual giant and rich at the same time. And the thing that bothers me, how many of you ever watch late night cable? Admit it. Come on, we'll have an altar call right now. Raise your hand. Okay. There's a guy in Hawaii. He's not a Christian. He's a real estate expert. And he has one shoulder that twitches like this. And he goes, tonight I'm going to show you here from Maui how to buy a hotel for $8. How many of you have seen him? Go ahead, admit it. $8, you'll get a hotel. And then you'll do a leverage buyout with junk bonds and buy two hotels. Then you change the channel. The next is you see this model wearing this necklace made out of allegedly diamonds with a guy pointing like this. Call in now. This diamond bracelet is worth $500 tonight. 28 cents. 28 cents. Then you can get the hood of your car that's been torched by napalm. Completely like it was before. And wait till you see what it does for your teeth. The 80-year-old woman that looks 40. The guy who lost weight without diet or exercise. Man, I thought about that one for a long time. How do you lose weight without diet or exercise? I came up with it. Disease. The next one is a preacher. Now remember, we've gone from Hawaii on the real estate to the white teeth to the good hood to the necklace, to the lose weight, to the preacher. And you can't tell the difference. And the tragedy is you cannot tell the difference. And you need to wake up and quit following these fools. Because they are Adonijahs. They tell you to get this string, put your hand on this and do that and the other, and you'll get 500% back on this. The Bible does not teach gospel ministry as the New York Stock Exchange. And what I'm going to tell you is I believe in seed giving, and I'm making a distinction now. I believe in the teaching of seed given. And tonight when the offering was received, Brother Avanzini's a man that I regard for his understanding of finances. And I make a distinction between that and the person that gets on like a huckster and says, give God your shopping list and he'll give you whatever you want. And I tell you what, many of those people are going to be shocked if they ever got down and prayed. And they give their shopping list to God. And they say, God, here's my shopping list. I want a microwave. I want a new car. I want a better house. I want this. And the Lord will say, and here's what I want. I want you to get rid of your lust and your greed and your pride and your arrogance. And I want you to get right with me. And then I want you to love the lost. And I want you to beat up on the devil and empty wheelchairs and cast out devils and get rid of pornography in your neighborhood. Help me, somebody. I don't want to raise the rent. I want to raise the dead. How many of you still love me now? It's getting better. David was old. And the appearance was that the God authority of this generation is silent or ineffective. And when that happens, Adonijahs start to get up and shoot their mouths off. When you have no clarion miracle, clear miracles, the kind of miracles where you get the x-rays and the tumor's gone, where the blood test is taken and the mouth of the doctor falls open and says, this person's AIDS virus is obliterated. When those apostolic foundational miracles are not active in the church, Adonijahs get up and start speaking. The spiritual bozos of our generation. And they unfortunately get young preachers to follow them. And they develop the wrong hero. Young lady, young man, look at me. You don't need those people for heroes. Get away from them. Get away from them as if they had the bubonic plague. Find yourself a right-on man of God. And if there ain't one that's right with God, under the age of 70, find the ones that are 70 and hang on to them with all of your heart. And I'm going to tell you something. There is an era. The Adonijah principle applies when Caleb, and this is why I'm looking forward to being old, see, because right now I'm what they call middle-aged. I don't like it. See, when you're young and you preach like this, people say, isn't he cute? He's young. He's immature. He doesn't know what he's saying. And better yet, they give me this out. He'll grow out of it. Then there's another era where you get old enough to start saying what you really think again. Because they say, oh, he's senile. Isn't he cute? It's everybody in between that messes everything up. Because we are respectable. I literally met a bureaucrat one time on a plane. I sat next to a bureaucrat. And so I said, why in the world would you ever want to be a bureaucrat? And he gave me a long lecture, and it was after it was over that I discovered that the object of bureaucrats is to jump into the river of progress and coagulate it. I said words to him that he didn't like. Courage, risk, controversy, vision. And they all, he changed seats. This is the kind of guy that when he went to see Jaws said, please seat me in the shallow end. Okay. That's the worst one I'll tell tonight. If you survive that, you're fine. Now, here we are. Adonijahs are on the right. Adonijahs are on the left. And they're easily recognizable. They merchandise their truth. Adonijahs are often people that really can't ever be recognized as great. So they have to tell you themselves. Without marketing and promotion, they are like yogurt. No flavor, no vitality, no compelling message, no answering to the evil of that day, no changing of the current that they live in. I want you to know that the object of a David is to save the nation agony by discerning the difference between an Adonijah and a Solomon. David was awakened. I'm not trying to get any more controversial than I need to, but David was so old that they put a beautiful woman in the same room with him and he didn't even notice her. That's old. It said he rolled over and went to sleep. Hey. Okay. How many of you still love me even though I said that one, did? That is old. Now it would seem on the face of it that David must really need help. For the beauty of this woman did nothing for him. He asked for an extra blanket. Meanwhile, this is an important aspect of Adonijah in verse 5. He said, I will be king. And he prepared for himself chariots and horsemen and 50 men to run before him. He has the appearance of a king. He has gone to rent a horse and gotten himself some kingly looking horses. He has gotten marketing skills and he for all the world looks like a king. Last Olympics, I was watching what has happened to America. America has an Adonijah spirit right now. We have style without substance. And an example of that was in the Olympics, was a young fighter from America up against a young French boxer. And here's what the announcer said about our boxer. He dances like Muhammad Ali. And he did. He moved and he grooved and he... Problem was, the guy he was against really didn't know who Muhammad Ali was. Now, I want to explain this to you about Muhammad Ali. He didn't just dance, he punched. And anyone that thought that he was a great dancer forgot one thing. I saw a videotape of him when he fought George Foreman in Zaire. And when he hit him with the left uppercut, he lifted a 225-pound man off the canvas with one punch. His feet came up off the ground. Now, Ali could dance, but he could punch your lights out. Now, the young American could dance like Muhammad Ali, but we're not talking Fred Astaire here. I mean, if you met Fred Astaire in an alley, you wouldn't say, "Oh, I'm going to be danced to death." So the man moved and grooved and did all of the stuff, and then he stood there shocked that his opponent was not intimidated. See, the French guy knew how to box. So he hit him. It was lights out. Adonijahs have all the appearance of anointing, preaching ability. They're great. They're marketed. They're the man of the hour. Everyone says they are. They're supposed to be. But ladies and gentlemen, where is the changed city? A year later after their crusade, where are the people that all got saved? I took a personal mathematical addition of all of the people that these Adonijahs have claimed have gotten saved in the last 10 years in America, and I have good news for you. America in its entirety has been saved three times over. So it's really a myth that abortion is still real, that drugs are still rampant, that churches are still abandoned, and that morals are nowhere. The fact is that we've suffered over the chariot parade of Adonijahs long enough. And they love to mouth off and divide ministries. They love to proclaim themselves and instead of letting God promote them, they accrue massive debt and are gone in an instant, and everyone wonders why. When all of it goes up in the flames of the most flammable substance known to ministry, hype. The devil doesn't regard hype. The world doesn't regard hype. The average sinner doesn't look at hype. What does the devil regard? Men who are gold, women who are gold, those that have paid to understand the truth of God. Wherever there's an Adonijah, there's a Solomon, but it's up to David to promote him. Go ahead and clap for Jesus. I'm going to move on now because I've spent enough time on Adonijah, and I'm going to get to this point. As I told you, David was not impressed with this young lady. He was old. And it would seem on the face of it, what would stimulate this man? What would arouse him? And I'm going to tell you, what was the stimulation and the passion of his heart was Bathsheba, his wife, went to Nathan and explained the times. Said, "My son Solomon and I have no hope. Without the appointment of the next leadership and the procrastination of deciding where the next leadership is going to come from, I have no hope. And the nation has no hope." And that is the spirit of America today. Our leaders. And the spirit that we have is that there is cowardice. There is spinelessness. And there is feet dragging and committees and layers of legal hassles and red tape. I could not believe it one day when several of our boys were murdered in the Middle East. And one of the members of our ranking government, an official, he was angry and said right into the camera, as I'm going to say right into the camera, he said, "You terrorists,
Now you've done it, we're going to study you. Now imagine the fear struck in the heart of the terrorists as they thought, right now, even as I sit here, I'm being studied. Adonijah forgot one thing, the heart of David. See, a man's not made up of what's going on in his body. It's what's going on in his spirit. And the worst mistake that anyone can ever make is to judge a man by his outward appearance. Wrong. Wrong. For when David sat there wheezing and cold and unable to be warm, the Bible says that Bathsheba came in with Nathan the prophet. And Nathan said the magic words. He said, the kingdom is in trouble. The kingdom is in trouble. And the fire that a young woman could never bring back, the warmth that a blanket could never bring, the thing that nothing else could do, the Bible says the fire returned to David's eyes. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Give God the glory. The man got up on one elbow and issued orders as if he were the same young man that killed the giant. The same one who governed over the mighty men. The same one who struck fear and terror in all the kingdoms of the world. He got up on one elbow and he said, get my royal cloak and set those horses and put Solomon, my son, in that chariot and parade him for the people and say, thus saith David. This is your king. This is your leader. And this is it. I'm going to tell you now that there are a lot of younger preachers that are puffed up with pride and arrogant, thinking that because they've led a few souls to Christ, sold some tapes, gotten a little bit of notoriety and publicity, that they're now Holy Ghost big shots. We need the older generation desperately. We need you desperately. Because you've seen the fire. You've seen the glory. You know the true miracles of Christ. You remember when people by the thousands are slain in the spirit. You remember the Shekinah glory in a ring that was photographed over the Hilton Hotel in San Francisco. You remember when nation after nation felt the fervor and the fire. And we need you. We need you to know the difference between gold and fool's gold, anointing and emotion, self-promotion and God-given favor. And you know what we need to do? Is don't let the devil divide the youth and the older generation. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it. Come on, somebody. I want you to move down a few verses in 1 Kings chapter 1. Verse 28. Then King David answered and said, call Bathsheba to me. So she came to the king's presence and stood before the king. And the king took an oath. And said, as the Lord lives, who has redeemed my life from every distress, just as I swore to you by the Lord God of Israel, saying, assuredly Solomon your son will be king after me, and he shall sit on my throne in my place, so I certainly will do this day. It is an amazing thing how when a man or a woman is truly a world changer, that invariably they will take an oath. It is astounding to me how our generation of preacher has been seduced into considering things that are trivial as achievement. We think of it as an achievement if our budget is a certain size. We think of it as an achievement if our empire impresses someone. What David was and what made David great was that at times when he didn't have to, he put his life on the line again for the sake of truth. We now have godless, carnal experts advising our preachers for the secure and safe and supposedly important life, when in fact there is no risk in it, there's no courage in it, there's no vision in it, there's no power in it, there's no hope of a grand thing. What we need now is to relearn the gift. The gift of enchanting our Christian generation with doing something for God that is massive and beyond them. Of jolting all of these life insurance mentalities, these insulated, this secure, this thermostatically controlled Christian, watch out, you're barely going to make it, spirit. Take our fear and slay it. When did you know the old David was back? When he got up on that elbow and he said, I'm going to take it all. There is a gentleman, and he's not looking for this adulation. I know him well. But Paul Crouch is a man that amazes me, because whenever I'm in his presence, God has done some astonishing thing. He glibly says, oh, the Lord has opened the Soviet Union to us. The way that a minister might say, we got a building permit. I need to ask you now to understand that David's greatness was retrieved by saying there is no such thing as a day of retirement for a man with God's hand on him. There is no such thing as a day when you won't have to have faith, where you won't have to face criticism, where you won't have to lay it all on the line. And if there's anything that my youth and walk with God teaches me, is not to look for safety, but to use the lessons of victory after victory after victory to make at the very core of my being an iron will that says, whenever I need to, whenever the devil lifts up his ugly head, whenever sinners control the government, whenever our public schools become a war zone, then I'm ready once again to get up out of that bed and be a lion for God and be a part of what the Lord is doing. You believe that? Hallelujah. The king took an oath, said, I'm going to do it. I tell you, you may feel like retiring over here, sir. See, I've been baptized in the Holy Ghost 55 years, Mario. I have a very dear friend. He's like a father to me, Vic Munyer. Vic Munyer is ushered in every single major Billy Graham crusade that's ever happened since 1948 in the Southern California area. And he's the youngest man. He's younger than me. He's about 74 years old, and yet he is younger than I am, and I know the secret of his replenishing his youth. He refuses to talk about what God used to do. And he's constantly getting up on that elbow and making an oath that if the kingdom's in trouble, I'm available. And I'm going to tell you, your job and my job, our job at this moment is to forego the Adonijahs. Tell them to sit down. It says about Adonijah this one word. In verse 6, it says his father had not rebuked him at any time by saying, why have you done this? We've raised a generation of spiritual brats. We've raised a generation of spiritual brats that believe God is going to give me whatever I ask for when I ask for it. In 1 Kings, it says that David made the oath And he swore that Solomon would become king. And so Solomon was crowned king. And here's what it said. In verse 40, if you look this way, it says, after they crowned Solomon king, something happened. Something was pent up and frustrated. Something was not present that suddenly was released. And it says the people went up after him, and the people played the flutes and rejoiced with great joy, so that the earth tore with the sound of them. Today, there is more firepower in the church than ever has been in the American church. We have money over here, talent over here. We've got anointing over here, opportunity over here. The devil's job is not to deprive the church of money or of talent or of anointing or of power, but to keep it from being a symphony. And that is a key word. And you see, the people wanted to believe there was a king, so they gave Adonijah kind of a yay. Kind of like the Price is Right type cheering. Come on down. And there is a breed of praise in the church, right? It's silly. It's not the cry of a warrior. It's a game show celebration. And it's over here and it's over there. But there isn't that wall of fire, that focused sense. Yes, this is right. When David got up and he said, ladies and gentlemen, as your king, I want to tell you what God is saying. And the new leadership was in place. The cry that went up from the people of God was so deafening that it tore the ground they were standing on. It says there was great joy. It says there was great power. And I'm telling you that right now, the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship is at a point where it will ride a new wave. Or by its own making, fade into monumental nostalgia and speak of days that were. You can be a David looking for a blanket, or you can get up on your elbow and say, you know what? I refuse to be put in a charismatic rest home. I'm going to be on fire as long as I'm on this planet. And I'm going to be a part of everything that God is doing. I'm going to be a part of everything that God is doing. Come on, somebody. Let me hear some Davids here. Let me hear some Solomons here. Let me hear the people of God. Let the Lord heal your heart right now. God, God. Hallelujah. I only have one little PS to add, and I'm all done. How many of you still love me even though I've taken this long, do you? You're merciful to me. You're being merciful to me. What do I do, Mario? If you're a Solomon, don't seek self-promotion. That's Adonijah stuff. Don't try to find out who is worth knowing or what should I do or who should I emulate or what opportunity I need. You don't need anything. Promotion comes from the Lord. A man's gift will make room for him and establish him. Quit surrounding yourself with flaky advisors. Get rid of them. The people that you need are the ones that don't always smile at you, don't always love you and the way you want to be loved, but they tell you the truth. And they speak to you of holiness and commitment and depth in God. Now next, I want to speak to fellowship leaders, wherever you may be. You need to turn your luncheons, breakfasts, and gatherings back into fiery evangelistic encounters in your neighborhood. You've got to do it. You've had enough teachers, enough deep thinkers, enough profound speakers. Get catalysts in there. Go back to those testimonies that used to shake people. Get a young ex-drug addict in there and let him talk a minute. Get a Solomon up there and let him say something. And then let a David come behind and give it balance and direction and force. But let the city know you need your chapter and your fellowship to rejuvenate itself in this sense, that this is a place where the lost are going to get saved and men and women in business are going to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is not going to be a deep, 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 deep teaching. This is going to be a profound launching. You're going to get something exciting going. And then you're going to tell those businessmen, look, I want to know if you're not bringing your unsaved friends to this meeting, why? And I think part of it has been our fault. And you admit it and confess it and say, you know what? We've been starting to cater to each other. And we're going to quit doing that. You go out, you tell them, you bring the unsaved. You bring the lost. You bring the addict. You bring the suicidal man and woman. You bring them in here, we're going to lay hands on them. Devils are going to come out of them. And they're going to have power in Jesus' name. And I want to say, more than anything else that I could possibly admire about this movement is your capacity to surrender to the Spirit when the Spirit begins to move. I cannot tell you that someone asked me, how long did it take you to prepare this sermon tonight? They asked me that. How long did it take you to prepare this sermon tonight? And I looked at him straight face. I said, 22 years I've been working on this sermon. 22 years ago, I was in college starving to death, as college students have an ability to do. I almost became a World Vision poster child in college. Had ketchup sandwiches without bread. And the Holy Spirit called me to preach in Berkeley. And we needed a building. And I was just an absolute nobody. I was just one bundle of excitement is all I was. And I would explain what God was doing in my heart to some minister. And they would stare at me the way raccoons stare at truck headlights. You know. You know, I'm trying to tell them what the Lord's doing in my life, and they're looking at me like, who can I get to help this guy? After being here and there and everywhere, I was invited and wandered into a chapter of the Full Gospel Businessmen in San Francisco in the 60s, where Cecil Cooper, who has gone on to be with the Lord, was the chapter president. And he gave me 5 minutes to open my heart what the Lord was doing in my life. And with that sense that it was doomed to failure again, I stood up there and I looked at those men and I said, brethren, the Lord has called me to reach the campus radical. I have bus fare and that's all I have. And something that had never happened to me before happened. There was a look in their eye that said, this is Jesus calling this young man. And when they said that, they took up an offering, and imagine, if you will, they took up an offering going back to 1965 among about 30 men of $700. With inflation, it was a ton of money. I'd never seen that much money. I assumed that I could buy an entire building for that amount of money. But I never forgot it. And I became very involved at many, many regional conventions and watching God work here and there and everywhere. Then word came back to me that Satan had stood up to attack this fellowship. I was not surprised. I knew what was happening. There's a 40-year period. There is a thing God is doing. There is a birth of a new movement. Within a movement. And the thing is that David's derived their eternal participation in a work of God forever, to the day they pass on to be with Jesus. They are permitted to have a cutting edge and stay at the forefront of what God is doing. If they see their occupation, and their occupation is this: I don't want an old spirit, I want a young spirit. I want to make oaths and commitments and appoint Solomons. I want to release people. I want to be alive. I want to continue to have a vision. So my heart for this movement is very clear. I believe that you must return to the roots of your movement, of evangelism, of reaching out, and discard in your fellowships those who would indoctrinate you with special teachings. Get rid of them. Secondly, I believe that you need to develop a spirit of generosity, so that when visions are shared, and I believe that this was the spirit after David made his commitment and made an oath and said, this is who's going to be king. Then he said, get my chariot. Get my horses. Get my best. And invested in the promotion of this leadership. And I'm going to tell you something. I want all of you that are listening to me to understand that when fear strikes a movement, the first thing they do is withhold. And they withhold because they don't see the clarity of what God was doing. They don't understand it. Mixed voices. And right now, I believe it is as clear as it could possibly be that God is about to pour out His Spirit on American youth. And I believe you're to be a David to this new movement. You're to be a David to this movement. You're to provide your best to help it happen. And I believe when you do that, you're going to watch power unfold. I'm closing. I want you in a moment to stand with me, and when we stand, in a moment, not yet, when we stand, I want you to leave something behind. I want you to make it the kind of a stand as you recognize when a sinner stands to receive Christ, they're leaving death behind and walking toward Christ forever. I want you to do something. I want you to recognize the areas where you have been seduced. You have been corrupted. You have been derailed. Maybe you have had several bitter experiences that have given you a critical spirit. Who is the victim of that critical spirit? Only you, my friend. For it robs you of that childlike attitude that would help you to celebrate everything God does for you. The critical spirit removes the color out of everything. The critical spirit deprives its victim of every enjoyment in life. Don't be wishy-washy and on the fence or spineless. Be delivered of that bureaucratic heart. Get rid of that red tape spirit. And understand that when you divest yourself of that, that you are going to make enemies. There's some people that want to be everybody's friend, and I'm going to tell you, you're going to die alone, and you're going to be everybody's disregarded trash. But when you know where the side of right, you're going to move on in power, and you're going to understand love. And we need a new baptism of power. This is my last point, but it has 22 subpoints. No, it doesn't. I have to say that for those that are here, this is a message not only to this convention, but the whole world. Now, everyone, please stand with me, if you will. Everyone, please stand, if you will. I want to ask you a question. What is it going to be tonight? Are you going to let a spirit age you? Are you going to get up and say, the kingdom is in trouble? I'm going to see what God's doing at this time and expect something fresh. When I understand the difference between an Adonijah, an unrebuked son, and a trained vessel, Solomon. I'm going to encourage, I'm going to support, and I'm going to work. Those of you that are young, and there are many, many of you here that are young. Those of you that are here that are young, please don't be seduced into thinking you don't need a David, because you desperately need a David. You'll never be a king without a David. Let the older generation understand that while their body might age, that there is the promise of eternal youth to those that completely are aware of the needs of the kingdom and want to continually expand them. In the name of Jesus. Everyone raise both your hands to heaven. Say this with me right now. Say, Lord Jesus, I am yours for this new thing that you are doing in the earth. I understand I have a vital place in your work. Please, oh God, deliver me from every spirit and attitude that would render me ineffective in hearing and obeying the very voice of God for right now. I reject everything that's fluff, everything that's foolishness, and I would be baptized again in the Spirit of God to know afresh the moving of your might on a hurting world. Everybody begin to pray in the Spirit and use that heavenly language right now. And remember, as you are praying, that God is giving you a fresh baptism of power. Remember that He is giving you
a beautiful clarion call, not only to the members of this great convention here, but in a very real sense, as Mario said, to all of us.